All stand, everyone standing, take your songbooks, go to song number 483, The Fight Is On. Song number 483, The Fight Is On. Song 483, The Fight Is On. The trumpet sound is ringing out, the cry to one is heard afar and near. The Lord of hosts is marching on to victory. The triumph of the Christ will soon appear. The fight is on, O Christian soldier, and face to face his victory. The heart of reading, the cause is reading, the right and wrong in history. The fight is on, the beat of rearing, be strong in his life.
Can I just be excited? I'm excited. We, as a church, have prayed for your son and daughter and a premature baby and a baby miracle right there. And there you came to church tonight. And it's just honor and thankful that you're here. But you all are here tonight, and God is already doing a good work. Let's open in a word of prayer. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we love you. And Lord, thank you for that miracle baby. And just thinking about the prayer just to have a child, and then the difficulties of the pregnancy, and then just, Lord, intervening in a special way. And Lord, that truly is a miracle baby. We're thankful for that. I'm so thankful that Rusty's son and daughter-in-law are here tonight. It just rejoices my heart. And Lord, I pray that you help us tonight to clearly see you, to be able to see the little things that you do. It's not just a little miracle here and a miracle there. They're all over the place, Lord. And Lord, when a soul gets saved, it's a miracle. And Lord, I pray you help us to see those. Please bless the service. We love you. We need you. In Jesus' name, amen.
That must be finished. There's a race that must be run. There's a mission to accomplish and a battle to be won. We've been called to take the challenge by God's might and through His Son. He will give us grace to complete the race, moving forward, pressing on.
For the hope of our high calling, toward the promise we've received, with the strength that we've been given, pressing on to victory. And toward the one who's run before us, as we lay
sing this together. Song number 31, a new name written down in glory. Song 31. I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that He always kept His word. And there's a new name written down in glory. And the Bible, and you sing the story.
Now. You have to understand, Brother Hatfield, I noticed. You know, I noticed the yawn during the singing right there. And I know why. I know why, because, you know, at 6 o'clock you came here and fried chicken galore. And I want to say thank you, Sister Gray. You and those ladies who put that all together did a fantastic job. Maria, you made that chili and did a good job. Gave me a bowl. It was wonderful right there. And then they had these desserts over there, these cupcakes. I went over and I saw an array of them, and I snuck two of them. I felt very guilty until I saw a young teenage girl that I won't mention her name, named Sarah, have four of them. And I won't mention her name at all right there, but it sure did make me feel a lot better that I only ate two of those things right there. You did a good job. And I want to welcome you. And so many victories right there. Philip, glad you are here. And actually got baptized last night at the Elizabeth City Baptist Church. And boy, I tell you what, I've been praying for you. John has been blessed by your help. You've been a tremendous, tremendous help. Went out soul winning with him on Saturday, did a good job, and that is a blessing. Miss Phyllis, glad to have you back, was with us on Sunday morning, Sunday night. And then Brother Jeff over here, you were invited by brother, where are you at? There you, Brother Eugene back there. Amen, glad and honored that you're here. And then over there, Miss Louise right there. We had a group of us go out, and we were praying that the Lord would allow us to meet somebody to come to church tonight. We went out at 4 o'clock, and Miss Beth, and you were helping out, and I'll tell you what, James, you were helping out, and Jeremiah, and I appreciate that, and we had a good group of people over there. Where else? Brother Paul Sinerico, and Joshua, and Joseph, and Levi, and I met a ton of people there, so I'll come tomorrow. I'll come the next day. And then all of a sudden, I ran up on you, Miss Louise, me and Brother Paul did, and you said, man, I just got done reading that gospel booklet. And you said, I want to come. And I am so thankful that you came. That's a blessing right there. Miss Pam, you brought Judith right there. We're honored and thankful. We're thankful that every one of you is here. We're going to sing the family of God that will get around and welcome you. If you did bring a guest tonight, I do have a book for you. And if you want to come down before this, during handshaking or after the service, you can come get that book from me. Here we go.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I'm a part
in the mountain, cleansed by His blood. Joint heirs with Jesus as we travel His song. For a part of the family of God.
Let's turn around and be friendly.
offerings. Anything that comes in undesignated is going to go for a love offering and just to help out with the expenses of the revival right there. And so I appreciate your faithfulness. Good to have the Quinby family from the Anchor Baptist Church there. It's a blessing. And David, you're somewhere around here. It's a blessing to have you. Brother Joel, if you'll come up here and lead us in prayer, I appreciate you. You travel with your job all over the place. It seems like you go from one place to the other place, but he always checks in. He's watching the services on Facebook and checking in, and he's been faithful, and I appreciate him and his brother Jigs over there. If you'll lead us in prayer for the tithes and offerings.
All right, let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you for this day that you've given us. I know we work a lot. We did some job over there and over here, but we give an effort to come, especially the Spring Revival. Help us and help Brother John Hamilton to be able to speak the Word of God, especially for our heart. Open our heart to be able to understand it and to be able to use that in our daily lives. And thank you for the opportunity to be here, Lord. We do give you praise. We do give you glory, Lord. And please bless this offering that we can spread your word more, not just this Chesapeake and more, especially like we had in Sardinia, we got in Philippines, we got Elizabeth City, Norfolk, and Suffolk. I mean, in Portsmouth, thank you for the faithfulness of our brothers and sisters willing to give their offering and their sacrifice, Lord. Thank you for all the blessing given us. Please bless this day and be able to learn your word and be able to give glory to thee. I ask this Jesus Christ, pray. Amen.
loving, he rescued my soul from death. And I will never be the same. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Powerful God, relentless in loving,
mercy and grace he pours out on me.
This is my God, this is my Lord, my love. With him I'll never be the same. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. And I will sing my story through the ages, like a wildfire in me. I can contain the words, the truth that he's written on my heart. And this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
The hour is approaching when the souls of man will hear a mighty shout resounding in the sky. In power and great glory, King Jesus will appear and take his children home to paradise. It will be a celebration for the ones who chose his name, but total separation for the ones who turned away. Are you ready for the trumpet? Are you ready for the call? Soon the angels will assemble to usher in the Son of God. Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call?
The Bible speaks of two men who were standing in a field where one is taken and one is left behind.
Two women in a kitchen, one goes and one remains. So get your house in order while there's time.
In the cross there is salvation, through the blood there is a way to secure your reservation on that resurrection day. Are you ready for the trumpet? Are you ready for the call? Soon the angels will assemble to usher in the Son of God. Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call? There's an urgency to reach the world. We have no time to waste. For within the heart of mortal man, the burning question now is raised. Are you ready for the trumpet? Are you ready for the call? Soon the angels will assemble to usher in the Son of God. Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call? Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call? For the call.
Amen. I'll tell you what, good preaching. Remember yesterday morning we had heard a sermon from the book of Luke on the fires of hell. Do you remember that? Praise God, we're saved by the blood of the crucified one. And then last night, do you remember that? Get off the porch and get in the house. And I want to let you know, I listened to that sermon. I've been on the porch for a long time in my life. And this morning I was very much under conviction and I decided to go into the house. It was this morning. You want me to tell you about it? It was this morning as I walked to the coffee pot. I've had coffee with cream and sugar for years. And so this morning I finally did it. I thought of the sermon last night and I poured me a black cup of coffee to the glory of God. I went in the house and got off the porch, my friend. Let's welcome Evangelist John Hamblin.
That's hilarious. Open your Bibles, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 16. We're thankful for each of you that are in the service tonight, and this is a marvelous Monday night crowd. Thank you, thank you, thank you for being in the revival meeting. I so appreciate all of the special music. I am not a musician, but I am married to an accomplished and anointed pianist, and I know good music when I hear it. And the singing tonight, just as it always does here at the Chesapeake Baptist Church, the singing tonight has set the stage, I believe, for the preaching of the Word of God. Whenever I'm around someone, Brother Ned Asheim, that says in my presence that singing, music, is not all that important in the work of God, I realize I'm listening to someone who really doesn't know their Bible. Because you can't read very far and you can't read very long in the written voice of God, the Bible, without seeing the great import that God has placed upon the ministry of music. And so I have been blessed by all of the special music tonight. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 16, and I'll begin reading with verse number 19 through verse number 23. Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, beginning with verse number 19 through verse number 23. And I would invite you to stand with me as I read the Word of God. I remember Brother Nettesheim as a young man, early in my ministry, on a Monday night, I attended a conference. I'll never forget it. I had just gotten saved. I'd just been called to preach. And I went on a Monday night to hear a fairly well-known preacher preach. He said, I quote, "I hate Monday nights." That's what he said. "I hate Monday nights." He said, "You preach all day Sunday, and then you travel, and you're back in the pulpit on Monday night." He said, "I hate Monday nights." And then he said, "I always coast on Monday night." Well, Brother Whitehouse, I must have telegraphed my disapproval and disagreement with that statement, because he then said, "You young preachers, you'll get to that place where you hate Monday nights too." Well, right there in my seat, I turned that pew into an old-fashioned altar, and I promised the Lord right then and there that if I ever get to preach on a Monday night, that I'll preach harder on Monday night than I did Sunday morning or Sunday night. Now, aren't you glad you came Monday night? I've got to be very transparent with you. I was a little bit tired this evening, but the preacher and this fine man of God picked me up a little while ago, and I asked him, they'll remember this, if we could stop at a gas station. I was feeling a little bit tired. They'll remember that. And I ran in and I got an energy drink. It was called Let It Rip. I drank every drop, and right now I don't give a rip. Gospel of Luke, chapter 16. I know you fellows will remember that. Amen. Wink, wink. Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, beginning with verse number 19 through verse number 23. "There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. It came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom." Please look back with me at verse number 21. Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, and verse number 21. "And desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table, moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores." Little phrase in this verse that I'll call your attention to. I've underlined it in my Bible. You may want to underscore it in yours. And it's that phrase, "Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores." Do you see it? There it is. "Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores." And for a few moments, I want to speak to you on the subject tonight, the hounds of heaven. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this privilege to stand behind a sacred desk to preach the word of God. If in my heart I want to be a blessing, but the only way that I can be is if you hide me behind the cross and fill me with the Spirit. Place a hedge around this great church by the blood of Christ to keep the devil and his demons from hindering this service. Save the sinner and stir the saint. Heavenly Father, for all that you'll do in our midst and even in our hearts tonight, we will be careful to give you all the praise and honor and glory. Bless and protect my precious family as I'm away. Give us fresh, warm bread from the oven of heaven to feed from tonight. Lord, I'd request, oh, how I would request that you'd clothe me in my calling. For we ask these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. You may be seated. God has special and supernatural hunting dogs that he uses to track, both by scent or by sight, hell-deserving sinners. A believer may not have had it cross their brain, but there are certain blessings that played a part to them being brought to Calvary. When a person understands the back story, they'll often have a more unique perspective on Bible salvation. The hounds of heaven. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, we find a peek behind the door of death for both the unsaved man and the saved man as well. This chapter could be easily or effortlessly outlined like this: the rich man and the steward, verses 1 through 18. And then the rich man and the street beggar, verses 19 through 31. It is well the physician Luke is dealing under the direct inspiration of the Holy Spirit with the rich man and the street beggar that a person sees, and often, Brother Nettesheim, missed detail of the comfort and care of the canines. Verse 21, moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Now in preparing this message, it dawned on me that there are a number, of dogs that are listed and lined out in the Bible. In fact, there are five, as I just think about it in passing, different dogs that are on the pages of the Bible. There are humble dogs, 2 Samuel 9:8. There's horribly dumb dogs, Isaiah 56:10. There's hungry dogs, Matthew 15:27. There's hellish dogs, Philippians 3:2. And then there is what I call in our text of Luke 16:21, heaven's dogs. One student of the scriptures once said about our text, the poor fellow, being Lazarus, was so helpless that even the dogs bothered him. Sidebar, I disagree, for I personally believe that they blessed him and that a robust rebuttal could be made that here is the birthplace of the old saying, a dog, man's best friend. The sister verse of Luke 16:21 is 1 Corinthians 1:28. And as you've probably heard me say any number of times in any number of services, every verse in the Bible has what I call a sister verse. And often that sister verse will throw more light upon the verse that you're musing, meditating, or making a study of. Again, the sister verse of Luke 16:21 is 1 Corinthians 1:28. And base, that's lowly, things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and the things which are not, to bring to naught things that are. Never forget, there are saints sinning all around this sanctuary that could stand and say it was the howling, oh my, and the hounding of some despised by the world hound that hung onto my heels all the way to that hill called Calvary. Now, if you miss everything that I preach tonight, I pray that you would not miss that. And it even bears repeating. There are saints. That's me. And that's you if you're saved. There are saints. There are saints sitting all around this sanctuary that could stand and say it was the howling and hounding of some despised by the world hound that hung onto my heels all the way to that hill called Calvary. Friend, you and I, both the unsaved and the saved, need to recognize the hounds that heaven will use to reach a heart. Now, quickly tonight, there are five dogs that do the Heavenly Father's direction in delivering sinners from hell. And they're all found on the pages of the Bible. Let's quickly notice it tonight. Now, you may want to take out a pencil. Oh, and somewhere in your Bibles, scratch these things down. But my, how it would be far better if God were to take an eternal pen and write these things upon my heart and upon your heart as well. The hounds of heaven. Number one, a paper witness. John 19:19, and Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross. And the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. A dog that does the Heavenly Father's direction in delivering sinners from hell is a paper witness. In John 19:19, the Apostle John tells us that it was Pilate, the fifth Roman governor of the province of Judea, who had the title placed upon the cross and put over the head of the lovely Lord Jesus Christ. A person must understand that it was in the case of Capitol, Brother Nolan, execution to put on a tablet the offense for which the condemned suffered. This tablet being placed in full view of all who witnessed the execution. Sometimes it was carried by the condemned, being hung around his neck in that day and district. It was a metal plate having black letters on a white background. The inscription was in Hebrew and Greek and Latin, John 19:20. Evangelist Oliver B. Green once said about this inspired incident, notice that the Holy Spirit placed the Hebrew language first. He would go on to say, this was the language of the Jews, the language of the religion in that day. Greek, Oliver B. Green said, was the language of science, philosophy, and culture. It was used by the learned people. Latin, it was the language of the law, the language used by the Romans. Therefore, Oliver B. Green said, all who gathered around the cross of Jesus could read Pilate's inscription in their own tongue, and in the realm of religion, science, and law, Christ was and still is King. Now, if a person will there keep all that in their mind and fast forward from then till now, while the Christian and the church does not pass out by the net of shine their metal plates, we most certainly pass out gospel tracts which do the very same thing that that grandfather of tracts did in getting a sinner to the Savior. Oh, if in the service tonight was that thief that was converted at the cross, if he was here tonight, I believe he'd say, oh yeah. I believe he'd say, amen. I believe he'd say, that's right. And a hound that does the Heavenly Father's bidding in delivering a sinner from hell. hell is a paper witness. One gospel track, oh my. One gospel track can circle the earth 1,000 times and be instrumental in putting countless names, in being instrumental in putting countless names into the Lamb's Book of Life. Friend, you and I need to recognize a hound that heaven will use to reach a heart is a paper witness. Oh, I don't know how that affects you, but I think I'll pass out one more gospel track. I don't know how that affects you, but I think I'll pass out another gospel track before today turns into tomorrow, because a hound that does the bidding, that does the business of the Heavenly Father is a paper witness. I read not all that long ago where Brother Whitehouse, a preacher in England, asked a dying Christian woman where she found the Savior. And she gave him a piece of paper torn from an American journal containing part of one of Charles Haddon Spurgeon's sermons. The scrap had been wrapped around a package that came to her from Australia. The words of Spurgeon were read by her and were the means of leading her to Christ. Commenting on this, the preacher said, think of it, a sermon preached in England, printed in America, and in some way coming to Australia, a part of it used as wrapping paper there, coming back to England, roughly 23,000 plus miles, were the means of converting this woman. Oh, I don't know if I mentioned it or not, but I don't know how that affects you, but I think before today turns into tomorrow, I'll pass out another track. I'll pass out another track. I'll pass out another track, because it is a paper witness, the hound of heaven, a paper witness. Number two, let me hasten, a prayer warrior. 1 Samuel 1:20, and called his name Samuel, saying, because I've asked him of the Lord, a dog that does the Heavenly Father's direction in delivering sinners from hell is a prayer warrior. In 1 Samuel 1:20, the prophet Samuel tells us that Hannah's barrenness was wrapped in a prayer of brokenness, which puts in her arms a bouncing baby boy. His name, Samuel, means basically heard of God. Friend, you and I need to recognize a hound that heaven will use to reach a heart is a prayer warrior. Sidebar, Brother Nettesheim, after hearing me preach this message for the first time back in 2019 at the Pleasant Hill Missionary Baptist Church in Detroit, Michigan, my brother-in-law, Scott Reese, who's now in heaven, said after the service, John, I know exactly what kind of dog that prayer warrior is. I said, Scott, what's that? He said, a bloodhound. Because since that's a mother from her knees, her prayers will always track you down. Oh, listen, there is a hound that does the bidding. There is a hound, this man you're letting on, there's a hound that does the business of the Heavenly Father, and that hound is a prayer warrior. Back in February of 2019, on a Thursday morning, I was to fly from Chicago to Lexington through Detroit. But because of Brother Nolan, fog, ice, and snow, my flight was not delayed, but totally canceled. When the Delta ticket agent made the announcement without even thinking, I said out loud, well, it looks like I'm not preaching tonight in Lexington, Kentucky. A young lady who was seated next to me said, I knew it, you're a preacher. I said, ma'am, how did you know I was a preacher? And I said, guilty as charged. How did you know I was a preacher? And she said, because as they've been, delaying flights, and as they've been canceling flights, everybody's been mad. Everybody's been upset. And she said, you've been calm, cool, and collected. I thought to myself, on the outside, I'm calm, cool, and collected. Now I have to tell you, seriously, it never bothers me to be at the gate and hear the announcement that the flight is delayed because of a equipment issue or equipment problem. That never, Brother Nettleshine, bothers me. I want to hear that at the gate. I want to hear that on the ground. I don't want to hear that up in the air in my plane seat. So it never bothers me to hear that at the gate. I reached in my pocket and I pulled out of my pocket what every Christian should carry on their person all the time. And that's a gospel tract. Amen. And I gave that young lady a gospel tract. And by the way, if your theology, can I go ahead and preach tonight? If your theology has a problem with gospel tracts, your theology has got problems. I reached in my pocket and I pulled out a gospel tract. I gave it to a young lady. Her name was Rachel. And I said, Rachel, I heard some good news from the Bible. Everybody can use some good news. And I gave it to her and she took it. And I don't know, my brother, maybe 7-9 minutes at the most, she nudged me and she said, Dr. Hamlin, my mother said to tell you hello and that you are her and my father's favorite evangelist. And they come to hear you preach all the time when you're preaching near their home. And I said, well, that's wonderful, but how does your mother know that? And she said, well, I took a picture of that gospel tract with my phone and I texted to her and she just texted back and said, you're sitting next to Dr. Hamlin at the airport and your dad and I, that's our favorite evangelist and we go to hear him preach all the time. Would you please tell Dr. Hamlin? We said, hello. Which I replied and said, please give your family my best, and isn't it a small world? Finally, I did make it to Lexington. I didn't make it in time to preach that night, but I think I got into Lexington at 11:45 on Friday morning. I went ahead and preached that Friday morning, and then Friday afternoon flew back home, and Friday evening, Mrs. Hamble and I were enjoying a very quiet evening at home, when an email came that she said that I needed to see. It was from Rachel's mom. And the email said, Dr. Hamlin, thank you for being so kind to my daughter in the Chicago Midway Airport. You didn't know it, but when you put that gospel tract in her hand, you're an answer to a mother's prayer. We're all planning on being in your service Sunday morning. 3 days later and 300 miles later, Rachel, her husband, their daughter, her mom and her dad were on the second row of the Sheridan Baptist Church in Saginaw, Michigan. And after a simple Bible message, the first one that stepped out and made their way to an old-fashioned altar was Rachel. You say, preacher, what are you saying? I'm saying a hound that does the bidding and does the business of the Heavenly Father is a prayer warrior. Amen. Number three, and I know I'm going to get stuck here. Number three, a preacher wide open. John 1:29, the next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world, a dog that does the Heavenly Father's direction in delivering sinners from hell, is a preacher wide open. In John 1:29, the Apostle John tells us that John the Baptist was not only the powerful forerunner of Christ, don't miss it, but also the perfect form of clergy. Friend, you and I need to recognize a hound that heaven will use to reach a heart is a preacher wide open. Now you do know that America is not in the shape she is tonight because the preaching has been too hard. No, sir, no, ma'am. America is in the shape she is tonight because the preaching hasn't been hard enough. And we've almost gotten to the place in America where we won't even say anything as preachers against spoiled milk, lest we hurt somebody's feelings. Oh, by your head, I'm nowhere near closing in prayer time. This is such good preaching, I can't wait to get back to the motel and sign that Gideon Bible in the nightstand 4 different times. Oh, a hound that does the bidding, that does the business of the Heavenly Father is a preacher wide open. Now, there are several obvious traits of that preacher that is often seeing people saved in his services from the ministry of John the Baptist. First of all, he is heard. John 1:23, he said, I'm the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah. Oh, an obvious trait of that preacher that's often seen people saved in his services, he is heard. God has never been interested in blessing preaching that resembles a golf whisper. Now, I'm just of the conviction that people on the front row and people on the back row ought to hear the same sermon. Had a dear lady come not too long ago, my brother, to hear me preach, and godly, wonderful, in fact, greatest Christian I know, prayer warrior, came to hear me preach. And she met me at the book table after the service and said to me, I just got a set of new hearing aids and I forgot them at the house. She said, I didn't hear the choir opener. I didn't hear the congregational singing. I didn't hear the announcements. I didn't hear the special music. My brother, I thought to myself, I hope you heard that offering. She said, I didn't hear the preacher introduce you. She said, but as soon as you hit that pulpit, even though my new hearing aids were forgotten at home, she said, I heard every word you said. To which I replied, thank you, Mom. Appreciate that, Mom. Thank you, Mom. Ah, nobody loves you like Mom. I tell young preachers all the time, you get in the pulpit, turn it on blast, and knock the knob off. We've got some Rick Warren wannabes. They're trying to hijack our fundamental movement. We got some, you say, preacher, I wouldn't say that. I know you wouldn't say it. That's why God had me say it. We've got some Rick Warren wannabes that are trying to hijack our fundamental movement. We got some Joel Osteen wannabes that are trying to hijack our movement. And God forbid, we even got, dare I say it, oh, you know I dare. We got some Richard Simmons wannabes that are trying to hijack our fundamental movement. And if a preacher sounds like he's wearing ballerina slippers while he's making announcements, you better run from that cat. You better run from him. And all God's sweet little children said? They said, ouch, that's what they said. Oh, an obvious trait of that preacher that's often seen people saved in his services. Listen, this new type of so-called preaching, they're preaching nothing, man. It's not preaching. It wouldn't even make a good ladies' Bible study. Say amen right there. The preacher that's often seen people saved in his services, he is heard. Secondly, he is humble. John 1:27, he it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoes latchet I am not worthy to unloose. An obvious trait Now that preacher that's often seen people saved in his services, seen from the ministry of John the Baptist, he is humble. It has never been about the messenger, but it's always about the master of the message. Amen. Now, while I'm on that, Brother Nolan, let me get on this. I don't know if I've ever seen a day where there's been so much pseudo humility, which is nothing more than genuine pride, that's going on in our country. People are so humble, they write books on it. People are so humble that they'll tell you how to do it. Well, they haven't even built a spiritual birdhouse for Jesus, but they'll tell you how to do it and how they were humble when they didn't do anything. And friend, hear me well tonight. Pseudo or fake humility is nothing more than genuine pride. I like what Evangelist Mays Jackson said in my hearing once. He said, every one of us are nothing more than a zero with the circle rubbed out. Amen. He's humble. Thirdly, he's hardworking. John 1:28, these things were done in Bethpara beyond Jordan where John was baptizing. You see an obvious trait of that preacher that's often seen people saved in his services, seen from the ministry of John the Baptist. He is hard working. Laziness is the modern day bane, the cause of catastrophic decline of the ministry. It's amazing, preachers. The harder I pray, the more God blesses. The harder I preach, the more God blesses. The more I witness, the more God blesses. Laziness has no place in the work of God. Oh, that every single individual that is in this service and watching by way of internet would realize that the traits of that preacher that's often seen people saved in his services from the ministry of John the Baptist, he is heard, he is humble, and he is hard working. The 16th president of the United States, you know, a legitimate one. Make America great again. The 16th president of the United States, Abraham Lincoln, may have stated it by the men I shine best when he said, I love to hear a man preach like he's fighting a swarm of bumblebees. A preacher wide open. Oh, listen, you talk about a hound that does the bidding, that does the business of the Heavenly Father. A preacher wide open. Man, that's how I got saved. That's how I trusted Christ. It was a preacher wide open that was used of God to see me miss hell. Amen. That's one of the hounds of heaven. Amen. A preacher wide open. Number four, a personal worker. John 1:42, and he brought him to Jesus. A dog that does the Heavenly Father's direction in delivering sinners from hell is a personal worker. In John 1:42, the Apostle John tells us that it was Andrew, right after he sits at the Lord Jesus Christ's feet, that reaches his brother Simon Peter. The six words, and he brought him, Brother Whitehouse, to Jesus, simply sum up the thirst, the task, and the thrill of personal soul winning. It was my mentor, Dr. Tom Malone Sr., who said in my hearing once, when with God working in your life, you are used to win a soul, you've done a greater work than creating a world or hanging a star in the sky. Friend, you and I need to recognize a hound that does the Heavenly Father's business in delivering a sinner from hell is a personal worker. Amen. Now, can I go ahead and preach? In some of our fundamental circles, it has almost gotten to the place where a personal worker is treated like a second-class church member. Now, no one should ever be treated like a second-class church member. No one. Amen. And especially a personal worker. And I'm against, from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet, I'm against treating anybody like a second-class church member. Especially a personal worker. But if we're going to do that, then we shouldn't. But if we're going to do that, then I say we should probably go ahead and treat those that are not personal workers like they're second-class church members. Even though, Brother Nolan, we should treat nobody like that. What I'm trying to say tonight is a hound of heaven, a hound of heaven, a hound of heaven is a personal worker.
Amen.
Amen. We got folks that are passing out water bottles. And they got two or three Bible verses on the bottom of them. And everybody wears a matching shirt. And they go to the train depot. Preach on, Dr. Hamlin. I'm trying. And they go to the train depot or the bus stop, and everybody in their matching t-shirt passes out a bottle of water with a couple verses on the bottom. You say, can anybody get saved that way? I don't know, but I do know a personal worker. I do know a personal worker. I do know a personal worker has been used time and time and time again. Now, we have to meet with someone for 35 coffee visits to get them to Calvary. Let me go ahead and roll a live grenade called preach under a chair or two. If it takes you 32 so-called coffee appointments to get somebody to Calvary, like it, lump it, bump it, jump it, take it across the street and dump it, you're not trying to win them to Jesus, you're trying to win them to yourself. Whoop! Goes right there. Friend, you and I need to recognize the hound that heaven will use to reach a heart is a personal worker.
Amen.
Dr. James Norton was a missionary legend. He was mentored by the Netta Scheim, by Dr. Bob Jones Sr., and he spent many decades in Japan as a missionary. One year at the National Sword of the Lord Conference, it would be 2004, he told me how he took a Greyhound bus from the Upper Peninsula of Michigan to Walkertown, North Carolina. Yes, I said a bus so that he could witness to lost people.
Amen.
Now, I don't know if you've ever taken a bus any distance at all, like traveling. But if you take a bus to travel, you're going to stop at places that aren't even marked on a map.
That's right.
And usually you spend about 48 hours right there. And here this missionary statesman, here this great servant of God said to me back in 2004 at the National Sword of the Lord Conference in Walkertown, North Carolina, he said, Dr. Hamlin, I took a bus from the Upper Peninsula in Michigan all the way to Walkertown, North Carolina so I could witness to lost souls.
Amen.
And then Ashim, he then reported that he distributed over 500 gospel tracts. Witnessed to 379 people and led 33 precious souls to Christ between Michigan and North Carolina. Oh, Dr. James Norton is in heaven tonight, and you got to know he's probably enjoying some very special hound dog status. A personal worker. And then number five, and last of all, I'm out. I'm out like Rosie O'Donnell in a beauty contest. I know I said that last night, but some of you didn't laugh then. And so I thought I'd give you another chance to laugh now. Not only a paper witness, would you look at our text? Verse 21, moreover the dogs came and licked his sores. Hi, Brother Philip. We got to meet and have lunch today, and I enjoyed it, and thank you for being here tonight. But isn't that amazing, Brother Philip? A dog. In fact, plural, dogs. And that's what heaven uses. Heaven's not interested in perfect people. And if there's any perfection in any of us, it's all because of the blood of Christ and the grace of God. He's interested in using dogs. And the dog that he uses, the Heavenly Father, to keep people out of hell is a paper witness. I'm not going to do it because I don't want to embarrass anybody, and I'm not wired that way. Really, I'm not. You think I am, but I'm not. But if we had a track check tonight, and I'm not going to do that, I wouldn't embarrass you. But if we had a track check tonight, I wonder who'd get caught without one. Hey, so what's track check? That's where you reach in your pocket and you pull out of your purse a gospel tracking, hold it up in the air. Now, Brother Nesha, I'm not going to do that because I don't want to embarrass anybody. But man, I reach into my pocket, and you know what? You know what I can feel? I can feel a pack of cigarettes. I can. Brother Nolan asked me to hold his while he was leading singing tonight. Oh, I wouldn't embarrass anyone. I'm not wired that way. I wouldn't embarrass anyone. But if we, and I'm not going to do it, but if we had it, I'm not going to do it, but if we had a track check tonight, I wonder who'd get caught with that one. Pardon me, I don't want to hear you sing if you don't have a gospel track in your pocket. I don't want to hear you pray if you don't have a gospel track in your pocket. I don't want to hear you play the baby grand piano, the upright piano, the grand concert piano, the organ, the kazoo that you have in the corner. I don't want to hear you play any instrument. I don't. If you don't have a gospel track on your person. And as I mentioned, if your theology, I don't know if I mentioned it or not, if your theology has a problem with gospel tracks, your theology's got problems. And it's a hound of heaven, a paper witness, a prayer warrior, a preacher wide open. Boy, that's what I want to be. I want to be a preacher wide open. That's a hound of heaven, a personal worker. Oh, that's a hound of heaven. But man, I've been looking forward to number five. Since the Lord laid the message on my heart late last night, when I got back to the motel room, number five and last of all, a pressing whisper. Acts 2:14, but Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you and hearken to my words. A dog that does the Heavenly Father's direction in delivering sinners from hell is a pressing whisper. In Acts 2:14, the Apostle Luke tells us that immediately after the upper room prayer gathering, there is an open air preaching meeting, and 3,000, oh my, people experience the free and the forever pardon of sin. Three phrases a person must not miss from this episode. Lifted up his voice, Acts 2:14. Now when they heard this, Acts 2:37, and then they that gladly received his word were baptized, Acts 2:41. D.L. Moody said that Pentecost, don't miss it, was a specimen day for all the age. But, Brother Nedesheim, a person must not miss that behind all the praying, preaching, and praising, Was the third person of the Trinity quietly, oh my, and earnestly speaking to the sinner's heart and saying, amen, 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 amen. Friend, you and I need to recognize a hound that heaven will use to reach a heart is a pressing whisper. When testimony time is called around the throne of God in heaven, when testimony time is called around the throne of God in heaven, when testimony time is called around the throne of God in heaven, God's children will learn of the 10,000 times 10,000 times 10,000 times 10,000 of the things a pressing whisper used to see people saved. And if you're saved tonight, you remember that gospel track. Maybe you're at work, maybe at school, maybe you picked it up somewhere. You remember that gospel track. And you remember how that you picked it up, and when you picked it up, you read the first preacher, the first half sentence, because before you got through the whole sentence, you realized it was a gospel track. And when that dawned on you, you couldn't get rid of it any quicker, but it seemed like there was Gorilla Glue on it and on your fingers, and you couldn't. And you couldn't, let go of it. And you remember at first half a sentence. And how you'd close your eyes to sleep at night. And you'd close your eyes, and it was like that first half sentence was tattooed to your eyelids. Somebody help me preach. And you remember something on the inside, and you'd later learn it was someone by the White House saying, you need that. You need that. You need that. Behind that paper witness was a pressing whisper. You remember coming home late at night, and it was so late that you didn't just missed the first curfew, you missed five curfews. And you tried to sneak down that hall, past that one certain room where the light was on. And you could see the light coming out from underneath the bottom of the door. And you tried to sneak past that room, having missed five curfews in a row. And you got about even with that door. And by the way, boards that never creaked before sounded like a marching band as you tried to sneak to your bedroom past that certain door. And you got about even with it. You heard a familiar voice on the other side say, Jesus, would you save him? Jesus, would you save her? Oh, Jesus, I know you died for them as much as you died for me. And something on the inside, you'd later learn by the Nolan, it was someone whispered and said, you're breaking their heart. You're breaking the heart of your mom and dad. But far more importantly, something on the inside said, you're breaking the heart of God. And you need to stop this nonsense. You remember that? A pressing whisper. Remember the first time you went to a fundamental church? I mean a fundamental church. I don't mean one that it says it's fundamental and it's no more fundamental than I'm an Elvis Presley impersonator. Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. Remember that first time you went to a real, bona fide, genuine King James Bible hymns on like Donkey Kong, fundamental church. You remember that? Amen. The preacher got up to preach. and you've never heard anything, and you've never seen anything quite like that. And if the coronavirus would have been going on, which, by the way, the coronavirus crisis has now morphed in to coronavirus craziness. But if the coronavirus was going on, you could have got the test from the preacher's finger. Because it seemed like while he was preaching, that finger was about that long, and you could get the coronavirus test on the back row while he was preaching. Remember that? And you couldn't wait to get out of that service. I mean, you got out of there like a scalded dog. And you couldn't even get off that parking lot. But something you later learned, it was someone on the inside said, you need that. You need to get saved. You're going to hell. You need that. You know what that was? That was a pressing whisper. Amen. Remember the first time you had a personal worker knock on your door. Oh my. And you thought they were Jehovah's Witnesses. But they were way too polite to be Jehovah's Witnesses. In fact, you kind of got the impression, conversation didn't last long because you ran them off, but you kind of got the impression that they would have sung the Star Spangled Banner, decorated a Christmas tree, took a picture, and sang happy birthday to you too. And you thought, that one will sneak up on you, get you about 2 o'clock in the morning. You thought they were Jehovah's Witnesses, and you ran them off. And before they could get off that porch and get to the sidewalk, something on the inside that you'd later learn was someone whispered and said, they have something you don't have. You were rude to them, and they still were nice. You were terse, and they still were nice. You were unkind. They still were nice. They got something you need. A pressing whisper. Now watch this. Don't miss it. Anybody that's ever saved, it's going to be a paper witness. It's going to be a prayer warrior. It's going to be a preacher wide open. It's going to be a personal worker. Brother Nolan, my new friend, it's those four hounds that the pressing whisper uses to see people saved. I'm closing with this. Once a man said, I quote, though I was saved so young, I remember a long series of incidents through which God spoke to my heart and convicted me of my sins. He said, I remember the Sunday school teacher and the lessons when we learned about the baby Jesus being born in a stable because there's no room for him in the inn. When I was but 5, I was deeply moved by a song my mother sang, turned away from the beautiful gate. I seem to have known it was by their own sinful rebellion and rejection of Christ that men miss heaven. About the same time, this man said, my mother, after I had told her a lie, talked to me with tears of how God hated a lie. The occasion was burned on my memory. I felt I deserved the just condemnation of God. Surely, this man said, God was speaking to me through his Holy Spirit. He went on to say, when my mother lay on her deathbed, she talked to me so of the Savior as she had all of us promised to meet her in heaven. After mother's death, I remember the tears and the exhortations of my Sunday school teacher. He said, I remember this man did, the godly pastor who told the story of the prodigal son. This would have been Reverend A. B. Ingram, how he ran away from home and came to want in trouble, and how he was forgiven on his return. How strange this man said, but it seems, oh my, that God must have been calling from the first day I knew anything about good and bad. From that first time I ever had a sense of moral responsibility to God. By the way, the name of that 9-year-old boy that was saved that Sunday morning at the First Baptist Church in Gainesville, Texas, was Dr. John R. Rice. A pressing whisper. If you're here and you're lost, if you're watching, lost. You may forget this evangelist. You may forget this church. You may forget a whole lot of things, but I promise you, you'll never forget what you're hearing right now. Because there is a hound of heaven called a pressing whisper that will stay on your trail until either you get saved or you step in to a Christless eternity. Our heads are bowed. Our eyes are closed. Luke 16:21. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. I wonder if every head bowed and every eye closed, who could lift their hand and say, "Preacher, I know that I know that I know that I know. If I were to die right now, heaven is my eternal home. I'm saved and sure." You'd lift it and leave it, saved and sure. Saved and sure. Saved and sure. Thank you. May I put them down? You're here tonight, dear one, and you couldn't raise your hand, but you would lift it now, and by raising it, you're saying, "Preacher, I need to be saved, and I need to trust Christ, and I sure don't want to die and go to a devil's hell." And right now, in this service, or watching by way of internet, Brother Andy, are we still on? Watching by way of internet, thank you, sir. You'd lift your hand and say, "I'm a sinner, and I need to be saved. Pray for me." You'd lift your hand. You're here tonight, and as a believer, and you want to be one of those hounds that does the bidding, that does the business of the Heavenly Father. Hands going up all over, all over. We stand to our feet, our heads are bowed, the musicians begin to play. Brother Nolan, if you, sir, would help me. These altars are open. Watching by way of internet. It's not an accident you stopped by tonight. It's called a divine appointment. And God in His goodness and grace, sir, ma'am, has given you this opportunity to trust Christ as your Savior. You're but a heartbeat from hell. You're but a breath from the bottomless pit. And Jesus wants to save you. Right there, the quietness of your home, in your den, in your family room, in your bedroom, I don't know, maybe driving down the road. Put the emergency flashers on and pull off to the side of the road and turn that steering wheel into an old-fashioned altar and ask Jesus to save you. Get right with God, whatever the decision needs to be. And then comment in the comment section. We'll rejoice with you in being saved or getting right with God. The hounds of heaven. The paper witness. Prayer warrior. Maybe you're here tonight and There's some people on your prayer list that when you come to their name, you wouldn't cross them off your prayer list. You wouldn't be that bold or brazen. But when you do come to their name, you halt and hesitate. Because it's gotten to the place where they won't let you talk to them about God. But here's the good news. They can't keep you from talking to God about them. And God can get their attention. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Who would lift their hand and say, "Preacher, I'm going to go back to praying for people that I've stopped praying for, or I've prayed for in disbelief and doubt." You'd lift your hand. God bless you. God bless you. A prayer warrior. Mrs. Nettesheim, at 9 years of age, a little red-headed girl in youth camp, had God speak to her heart about marrying a preacher. 9-year-old girl. She went to the altar that night and said, "Lord, I believe you've spoken to my heart about marrying a preacher. And Lord, what I'm going to do is, every night before I go to bed, I'm going to pray that you'd save a young man, call him to preach, and let his path cross with mine, that I might marry a preacher." And that redheaded girl, from 9 to 17, prayed that prayer. Her last name then was Reese. That was her maiden name. Tonight, preacher, her married name is Hamlin. And I don't believe that I'd be here. I do not believe that I'd be saved and in the will of God and preaching across this country every week of the world if it wasn't for a little 9-year-old girl's prayers. A prayer warrior. Hear me tonight. We don't need to reinvent the fundamental wheel. We just need to get back to what we know works and start working it. The hounds of heaven. If you're here tonight lost, man, I wouldn't leave that way. If you're here tonight and backslid, I wouldn't leave that way. If you're here tonight and you fill in the blank, whatever it is, I wouldn't leave that way. God's dealing with you. I'd get it taken care of. The hounds of heaven. Pastor comes.
Listen, on the way out tonight, everybody here gets a book, and the usher will have this, Seven Public Enemies of Fundamentalism.
Amen.
And, I want to look at this, and you can read this. Calvinism is an enemy of fundamentalism. Pragmatism is an enemy of fundamentalism. Formalism is an enemy. Amen. And by the way, you say, what does that mean? Well, read the book.
Right.
And
right.
Praise the Lord. Formalism, professionalism is an enemy of fundamentalism. Racism is an enemy of fundamentalism.
Right.
Narcissism and intellectualism. It's an excellent book. Praise the Lord. You get that.
Amen.
Then tomorrow, you're going to get 7 reasons I cannot become a compromising liberal.
Amen.
And you say, what in the world that's
Amen.
All about?
Well,
come tomorrow and you'll get your
that's
book
right.
and you will know. It'll be a blessing. Tomorrow night we have pizza to the glory of
Amen.
God the Father. And praise the Lord. It's been good. I appreciate
Amen.
You families. I appreciate you folks coming tonight. And you know, faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the Amen. Word of God.
That's right.
It's wonderful to be in revival.
Amen.
And praise the Lord. It's a little bit of a stepping stone. You go to Monday night.
Amen.
Tuesday night's going to be
Come
great.
On.
Wednesday night.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
That's
Otis
right.
family. Man, you had a rough time. Your car got a flat. You've been struggling with that, but you made it here. I appreciate
Amen.
That. It's a blessing.
That's
and let's
right.
do this. Let's close in a word of prayer. Brother Randy, if you'll come up here and close us in a word of prayer.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Take your time.
What?
He took that from his wife.
Amen. So. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for feeding us tonight, God. Thank you so much for what you've given us tonight, God. God, help us to realize that the world needs us to be prayer warriors. The world needs us to go out and win them to Christ. The world needs us to be right with God. God, we have one chance and one chance only with some people who to give them the gospel. To make sure they're saved, God. God, I pray we do it, God. I pray we use our whole life to honor you, to glorify you, and praise you. God, help us to come back tomorrow and be in our place. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.